Okay, good morning everyone. So today we are going to learn a new chapter, chapter 5, surface chemistry. Okay, chapter 5, surface chemistry. Do you have any idea about this topic? Surface chemistry. Michael, anything to share? Nothing. Naureen, can you tell me? Surface chemistry.
Reactions on surface.
Yes, that's it. Okay, here we are dealing with the surface phenomenon. Okay, here we are dealing with surface phenomenon. Chapter 5, surface chemistry. Okay, surface chemistry, it is concerned with phenomena that occur at the surfaces or interfaces. What do you mean by interface? In between two faces, right? So, surface chemistry, it is mainly concerned with the phenomena that occur at the surfaces or interfaces. The surface, it is represented by separating the bulk faces by a hyphen or a slash. So what's the difference between bulk and surface? Bulk. Achyut, can you tell me? Bulk. What do you mean by bulk of a substance?
I don't.
Inner portion, that's it. Other than the surface. Okay. So we can able to separate this bulk faces with the surface by a hyphen or a slash. Okay, we can separate this bulk faces from surface by a hyphen or a slash. Example, the interface between a solid and gas. We can write it either solid hyphen gas or solid slash gas. That means the bulk is solid and the surface, it consists of gas. It's just a border between two things. So you have considered this solid. It's made up of solid, right? Then this one is its surface. Here it is air, right? So this border or this interface can be separated by solid, then hyphen gas or solid slash gas. Then certain examples for such surface phenomenon. Corrosion. We have learned corrosion, right? As the destruction happens to the metal on its surface, then electrode processes, crystallization, dissolution at interfaces. These all are examples of certain surface phenomena. We will learn more in this chapter itself. Okay, examples of such surface phenomena. So, surface chemistry, it is mainly concerned with the phenomena that occur at the surfaces, or otherwise it is known as interface, surfaces or interface. The surface, it is separating from this bulk using either hyphen or a slash. Example, if the interface between a solid and gas, we can represent it as solid hyphen gas or solid slash gas. Then examples for certain surface phenomenon, corrosion, then electrode processes, that means both oxidation and reduction, crystallization, dissolution at interfaces, etc. These are certain examples of surface phenomenon. All of you, please switch on your videos. Completed, right? Rijaz, Emmanuel, finished?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Okay. All of you finished, right? Okay. Then we are moving to a new term. Are you familiar with the term adsorption? Adsorption. 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 Okay. So write down the heading adsorption. It is similar to that of absorption, but the only difference is that it is accumulated or concentrated only at the surface. The accumulation of molecular species at the surface rather than in the bulk of a solid or liquid, it is called adsorption. Clear? It is similar to that of absorption, but here the particle is concentrated or accumulated only at the surface, not to the bulk of that medium. So this process is known as adsorption. Okay? Adsorption, the accumulation of molecular species at the surface rather than in the bulk of a solid or liquid, it is called adsorption. And there are two components in this adsorption. First one is known as adsorbate. Adsorbate. And the second one is adsorbent. First one is adsorbate and the second one is adsorbent. So these are the two components of adsorption. Adsorbate, the substance which accumulates on the surface. The substance which accumulates on the surface, it is known as adsorbate. The substance which accumulates on the surface, it is known as adsorbate. And the second one is adsorbent. The material on which adsorption takes place, it is known as adsorbent. So in this example, you can see that activated charcoal is there, then the gas molecules are accumulated on its surface. Right? And in this example, this activated charcoal is there. On the surface of this activated charcoal, gas molecules are accumulated. So this gas molecules is considered as the adsorbate and this activated charcoal is considered as the adsorbent. The substance which accumulates on the surface is adsorbate. Here the gas molecules are accumulated on the surface. So this gas molecules are considered as adsorbate and this material on which adsorption takes place, it is known as adsorbent. Here the activated charcoal is the material on which adsorption takes place. It is known as adsorbent. So these are the two main components of this adsorption. And the solids like charcoal, silica gel, clay, etc. have larger surface area because they are very finely divided substances. Okay? Due to their smaller size, they have very larger surface area, which makes them good adsorbents. So the substances which have larger surface area can act as good adsorbents. Examples for such adsorbents, charcoal, silica gel, clay, etc. Clear? Solids with larger surface area. Mostly this larger surface area, it was shown by finely divided substances. Okay? They can act as good adsorbents. Sania, Anna, Anthony, Srihari, Muhammad Adim, Shivani, Donna, Steffi, Malavika, all of you please switch on your videos. Malavika, can you please read the slide?
The accumulation of molecular species at the surface rather than in the bulk of a solid or liquid is called adsorption.
Okay.
Adsorbate, the substance which accumulates on the surface. Adsorbent, the material on which adsorption takes place. Solids, charcoal, silica, gel, clay, etc. have larger surface area and finely divided state, which makes them good adsorbents.
Yes. Have you completed, children? Okay, then we can learn certain examples for this adsorption. Examples of adsorption. Okay, examples of adsorption. First one, powdered charcoal. Okay, powdered charcoal adsorb different gases. Types of gases on its surface. Why is it in a powdered state? Powdered state. We told you that if the surface area is large, this adsorption process take place very easily. Okay. So if it is in finely divided state or powdered state, the surface area will increases and it will leads to more adsorption. That is the reason. Then the second example. Animal charcoal adsorb methylene blue. It's an example for a dye with a blue color. Blue color. Okay, methylene blue. It's an example for a dye. Animal charcoal adsorb methylene blue and it will become colorless. We just add this animal charcoal and shaken well with methylene blue. After some time we can see that this methylene blue color, it is changed to a colorless one. Okay, that's the process. Simply adding this animal charcoal and shake the mixture. That's it. Okay, then the third example, rose sugar. The remaining, that's after the burning process of this animal remains. That's it. Do you know about charcoal, right? Yeah, same thing, that's obtained after the process of animal burning. That's known as animal charcoal. Yes. Then next one is rose sugar. Do you know the color of this rose sugar? Rose sugar. Yeah, it's brown color. But the sugar available in the shops, it's in colorless, right? Or white color. That's also occurs by the adsorption process by this animal charcoal. Then air becomes dry in the presence of silica gel. This is also an example for adsorption process. Air becomes dry in the presence of silica gel. Because this water molecules can be adsorbed at the surface of the silica gel. So these are the different examples of adsorption. In the last case, the silica gel acts as adsorbent. Okay. Is this clear? Yes, right. Okay, then there is one more process that's related to the surface phenomenon, that is known as desorption. This is just opposite to that of adsorption. Okay, the process of removing an adsorbed substance from a surface on which it is adsorbed is called desorption. Just removing that adsorbed substance from the adsorbent, it is known as desorption. The process of removing an adsorbed substance from a surface on which it is adsorbed is called desorption. Okay. Next, we are going to compare the phenomenon that is adsorption and absorption. Adsorption and absorption. So in the case of adsorption, substance is only concentrated, no need to write again only. Okay, substance is only concentrated at the surface and does not penetrate through the surface to the bulk of the adsorbent. And in the case of absorption, substance is uniformly distributed throughout the bulk of the solid. Okay, in the case of adsorption, substance is only concentrated at the surface and does not penetrate through the surface to the bulk of the adsorbent, and in absorption, substance is uniformly distributed throughout the bulk of the solid. And if both adsorption and absorption take place simultaneously, it is known as sorption. Okay, if both adsorption and absorption take place simultaneously in a substance, it is known as, the phenomenon is known as sorption. Clear? In the case of adsorption, it's a surface phenomenon. That means the substance is only concentrated or accumulated at the surface. And in the case of absorption, it is directly accumulated or concentrated to the bulk of that medium. And it is uniformly distributed. When you dip a piece of chalk in an ink, you can feel that its surface is accumulated with ink, right? And when you break that chalk into two pieces, if ink is present in the bulk of that chalk piece, you can say that adsorption, along with adsorption, absorption also take place. Clear? So that means sorption is take place there. Both adsorption and absorption take place. If that ink particles only there in the surface, we can say that only adsorption take place there. Okay, only adsorption take place there. So in processes in which both adsorption and adsorption take place simultaneously, it is known as sorption. Clear? It is known as sorption. Aditya, can you please read the slide?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah.
In adsorption, substance is only concentrated at the surface and does not penetrate through the surface to the bulk of the adsorbent. In absorption, substance is uniformly distributed throughout the bulk of the solid. In sorption, both absorption and adsorption takes place simultaneously.
Yes. Have you completed, children?
No.
Okay, then you can write it. Finish, right? Achyut?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So today we have learned about adsorption, absorption, sorption, then desorption, etc. Do you have any doubt in these terms? Anyone? Nothing, right? Yes, Steffi? What do you mean by surface chemistry? All of you, please switch on your videos. Yeah.
Ma'am, I was there from the start of adsorption.
Okay, you can just go through the slide. Yes, it's mainly concerned with the phenomena that occur at the surfaces or interfaces. Okay. And we can separate this bulk with interface or surface using either hyphen or slash. And examples for certain surface phenomena: corrosion, electrode processes, crystallization, then dissolution at interface, etc. Okay? Yeah. Evelyn, what do you mean by adsorption? Adsorption.
The accumulation of molecule species at the surface rather than in the bulk of a solid or liquid is called as adsorption.
Adsorption, okay. Which are the two components of this adsorption, Gayatri?
Yes, ma'am. I didn't hear the question.
Which are the two components of adsorption? Unmute.
Adsorbent and adsorbate.
Okay, adsorbent and adsorbate. Emmanuel, bulk phase means that inside that substance. Okay. Other than the surface. Clear? The inner portion of that substance, it is not bulk. It is known as bulk phase. Inner portion. Okay. Yeah. Sania. What do you mean by adsorbate?
Substances which accumulate on the surface.
It's known as adsorbate. Then what about adsorbent? Sharon?
The material on which absorption takes place.
It's known as adsorbent. Then what do you mean by sorption? Nevin? Sorption.
Absorption.
Sorption. Sorption. Yes, Gauri. Sorption.
Adsorption and absorption can take place simultaneously.
Okay. Both adsorption and absorption take place simultaneously. Such a process is known as sorption. Then what about desorption? Shivani, desorption.
The process of removing an absorbent substance from a surface on which it is sorbed is called desorption.
Okay. The process of removing an adsorbate from the adsorbent is known as desorption. Okay. Then what's the difference between absorption and adsorption, Punya?
In adsorption, the phenomena occurs only at the surface and the substance does not penetrate into the bulk.
Yes.
In an absorption, the substance uniformly distributes throughout the bulk.
Yes. Okay. Then we are moving to the mechanism of this adsorption. Okay. Mechanism of adsorption. Okay. When you look at this image, it will be more clear about adsorption and absorption. Okay, in the case of adsorption, this adsorbate only at the surface, right? And here the particles inside the bulk of the media. Okay. Next heading, mechanism of adsorption. Mechanism of adsorption. you just consider the solid. Okay, you just consider the solid. Inside the solid there are different atoms or molecules, right? Or different particles there. And this each particle is attracted from all sides, right? When you consider a single particle, it is balanced equal forces from all sides, right? Isn't it? And when you consider one particle at the surface, okay, one particle at the surface. In this case, consider this particle. Here the forces are acting only from the sideways and from the bottom of this portion, right? There is no such balancing force from the top. In this case, equal forces are acting from opposite direction. In the right side and left side, there is one particle, and in the top portion and bottom portion also another particle. So there is balancing forces in the case of particles inside the bulk of the medium. Then when you consider a particle at the surface, there is no such balancing force there. So there is a tendency to accept or making such a force with another particle. That leads to this adsorption. Clear? That leads to this adsorption. Here there is no balanced force. No balanced force. So there is a tendency of molecules at the surface to attract or accumulate some particle to the surface. Okay, that leads to this adsorption. So you can write here, consider molecule inside the bulk of the medium. Balancing force just wait act from all sides. Case of a molecule at the surface, there is an unbalanced force . These unbalanced force are responsible for adsorption. Okay, have you completed? Meenakshi, can you please read the slide?
Consider the molecules inside the bulk of a medium. Balancing forces act from all sides. But in the case of a molecule at the surface, there is an unbalanced force. These unbalanced forces are responsible for adsorption.
Yes, these unbalanced forces are responsible for adsorption. Okay. Shall I move to next page, children? Yes. Then due to this adsorption, there is some change in the thermodynamic terms. Okay. So due to adsorption, can you tell me this adsorption belongs to either endothermic process or exothermic process? Yes. It's an example for exothermic process. Okay. So here the surface energy decreases due to adsorption. Surface energy decreases. Then next point. Delta H. What do you mean by delta H? That you have learned in thermodynamics chapter. Delta H. Yeah, Meenakshi? Yeah, that's it. Change in enthalpy. Okay. Change in enthalpy. It is negative. Delta H is negative. It's an exothermic process. That's the reason. It's an exothermic process. The next one, delta S. What do you mean by delta S? Vidur, what is delta S? Anyone? It's a term related to this enthalpy, similar to that of enthalpy. Can you tell me? Punya?
Entropy.
Yes, entropy. So here it is, change in entropy. This is also negative. And next one, delta G. Delta G must always be negative. Negative for feasible reactions. Okay. If a reaction is feasible, the delta G value must be negative. And there is one equation for delta G, that is delta H minus T delta S. Delta H stands for decrease or the change in enthalpy, then delta S stands for change in entropy, T stands for temperature. So for all feasible reactions, delta G must always be negative. So in order to make this delta G negative, what signs are there for this delta H and delta S? Can you tell me? In order to make this delta G negative, delta H value should be more negative compared to that of T delta S, right? If the first term is more negative, delta G is negative, isn't it? In order to make this delta G negative, the first term of this equation, that is delta H, should be more negative compared to that of T delta S, right? And if delta G is equal to 0, that means the system attains equilibrium. For a feasible reaction, delta G always be negative. In this case, delta H and delta S also negative. So delta H must be more negative compared to that of delta S. Yachu, you can ask.
What is delta G?
Gibbs energy or free energy. It's also known as free energy. Okay, so these are the changes that happens to the thermodynamic terms due to this adsorption. Okay, due to adsorption, surface energy decreases. Then delta H, that is the change in enthalpy, it is negative because it's an exothermic process. Heat energy is released. For all exothermic process, the charge of this delta H, it is negative. The next one, delta S, that is change in entropy, it is also negative. Delta G must always be negative for all feasible reactions. Okay, then delta G, Gibbs energy equal to delta H minus T delta S. So in order to make this delta G negative, we have to make this first term more negative compared to the second term. Otherwise, it will be positive, right? And if delta G is equal to zero, that means the system attains equilibrium. No more reaction take place there. Rate of forward reaction and rate of backward reaction, that maintains equilibrium or equality there. This is clear? So that's about the mechanism of adsorption. Okay, let me ask one thing. What do you mean by this feasible reaction? Feasible. All of you, please switch on your videos. Yeah, tell me feasible reactions. It is otherwise known as spontaneous reactions. Okay, the reactions which take place without the help of any other external agency. Clear? Spontaneous reactions. Reactions take place without the help of any other external agency. Such reactions are known as spontaneous reactions. The same condition is maintained for this spontaneous reaction. Delta G must always be negative. For all feasible reactions and for all spontaneous reactions, delta G must always be negative. Spontaneous reactions are the reactions they take place without the help of any external agency. Okay, is this clear? Is this clear, children? Yes.
Ma'am.
Yeah, Gauri.
Ma'am, feasible reactions and spontaneous reactions are same.
Not all feasible reactions are spontaneous reactions. Okay, feasible means if that there is one possibility for the reaction to take place, it is feasible. Okay, spontaneous reactions are the reactions which take place without the help of any external agency. In the case of feasible reactions, some reactions take place with the help of external things. Okay, but in the case of feasible reactions and spontaneous reaction, the condition is same. Delta G must always be negative. Clear, Gauri?
Yes.
Okay. So today we have learned about surface chemistry. Then certain new terms there, that is adsorption, desorption, sorption, adsorbent, adsorbate. So you have to familiar with all these terms. Okay. Then the types of adsorption we can discuss in the next class. Okay. Just wait, let me take your attendance. Okay, children, then thank you all. See you in the next class. Bye. Yes, Sharon.